Good morning. Welcome to High River United Church. My name is Carrie Belke, and I will be shepherding us through the service today in the absence of our pastors, David and Susan, who are away. I thank you for your patience. I thank you for your generosity of spirit as I fumble my way along. I think we'll make it. I'll meet you at the end. I'll start with our greeting that's printed in your bulletin. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. As settlers on this land, we are called to live in right relationship with the peoples of the traditional lands of the Treaty 7 and Métis 3 nations. May we be attentive to this relationship every day. Would you please stand as you're able and join me for our gathering hymn, Be Thou My Vision. It is in your Voices United hymnal, number 642, or I think it'll be projected as well. So please join me. Oh, it's not going to be projected. So go ahead and grab hymnals. Pass one down. Brenda, play a little extra so that we can have time to grab those hymnals. You can be seated. So it's time for our welcome and announcements. Welcome all on this final Sunday of July. It's going to be a hot one, so please just either stay in the air conditioning or just take it easy. I'm American. I'm from Ohio, and right around this time of year, every year, I get really mad because I moved to the Great White North. I should not have to sweat. I do not handle heat well. I get really grouchy. So let's just get through and look forward to the fall. There are a number of important announcements printed on the back of your bulletin. There's a This Week at a Glance in the High River United Church. Next week, we get to welcome Pastors David and Susan back, so that will be nice. And we're really looking forward to, I know I'm really looking forward to our what we're calling our Spirit Camp coming up in August. It'll be what I kind of grew up naming Vacation Bible School. We're going to have singing. We're going to have games. We're going to have crafts. It's going to be a great time. So if you know anyone who is kindergarten through grade six, please give them a reference for this fun new program or fun program that we're going to do this year. They can call and register their child at the office here at the church. And we are also looking for helpers who would be willing to make and provide snacks or a lunch. We're going to be having 3 days. So if that's something you'd be willing to do, that'd be great. You can talk to Reverend Susan or me. We've got Sit and Be Fit with KJ Johnson on Tuesdays and Thursdays at 11 starting in August. Thursday evenings, we've got yoga here with Derek Rowe from 7 to 8. I think they do that here in the fellowship hall. And then there's a walk coming up from Claire's home to Waterton. So if that's something that interests you, you can contact Reverend Joanne Anquist, and her email address is there. Are there any other announcements that weren't printed in your bulletin that need to come up for discussion? Does anybody have anything else? Okay, good. Sounds like we got it. And as always, if you are not receiving the weekly emails from the church office and you would like to be in the loop to the life of the church and what's going on each week, please call into the church office and have Ashley add your email address so you can be kind of on par, on target with what's going on. Yes. Yes. Oh, have we done July birthdays? Oh, thank you, Grace. Thank you. Okay, if you have a July birthday or anniversary, would you please stand at this time? I know I am a July birthday. Dale, Maureen. Oh my goodness, look at it. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. May God bless and keep you. Happy birthday to you. Good job, birthday buddies. Thank you, Grace. Excellent. All right. Would you please join me in the call to worship that's printed in your bulletin, on the front page of your bulletin? I will read the light print and you'll read the dark print. Children of God, welcome. Welcome to this place of love and grace. Welcome to this place of hope and perseverance. God invites all of us to be part of this beloved community. God invites all of us to share in the good news. We are welcome just as we are. We are loved just as we are. In gratitude for all of this, let us worship God. And would you please join me in reading the prayer of the day? Thank you, God, for children who are curious, unafraid, and infectiously joyful, who are trusting receivers of God's grace. Thank you, Lord, for the young who demonstrate courage and hope as they begin new adventures. For those in the middle years of life, we give thanks, dear Lord, for steady hands and hearts that guide the young and offer their experience to us all. For those grown up and grown old, dear Lord, We celebrate your special gift. We give thanks for joys seen only through the eyes of those who are wise in their age and whose stories can enrich all our lives. Open our eyes to the joys and gifts to be learned and shared from all the seasons of life. And at this time, we light the Christ candle. We welcome the presence of Jesus into the service and into our lives. We invite him here to be with us, to guide us, as we experience this time of worship and as we praise his name in all of our lives. Now you've noticed that there are a lot of hymns in this service today because I really like singing hymns. So would you please remain seated this time and we will sing another hymn. This is Tell Me the Stories of Jesus, Voices United number 357. Voices United 357. Remain seated, take a load off, and let's enjoy a nice hymn.
Slain.
right. Would our children like to come up for a little bit of a story time? Do we have any youngsters who I can read a little story to? Okay, you'll have to humor me a little bit. I'm feeling a little bit nostalgic. I didn't have my children with me all week this week. They went to camp. They went to church camp at Camp Kasoda. So I'm feeling a little bit mothery, and I wanted to share a story that involves some of the feelings that I had this week. I think a lot of you might be able to relate. This is called Someday, and it's by Allison McGee and Peter H. Reynolds. I do want to read the inscription to you. This was a gift when I was pregnant with my oldest daughter, Hoxie, from someone that we know in this church family, Tanis Shakya. And she wrote, this is from December 2012, she wrote, "Carrie, a mother's joy begins with new life, when new life is stirring inside, when a tiny heartbeat is heard for the first time, and a playful kick reminds her that she is never alone. Congratulations on your beautiful daughter-to-be. Cherish every moment. Best wishes, Tanis." "One day I counted your fingers and kissed each one. One day, the first snowflakes fell, and I held you up and watched them melt on your baby skin. One day, we crossed the street, and you held my hand tight. Then you were my baby. Now you are my child. Sometimes when you sleep, I watch you dream, and I dream too. That someday you will dive into the cool, clear water of a lake. Someday you will walk into a deep wood. Someday your eyes will be filled with a joy so deep that they shine. Someday you will run so fast and so far that your heart will feel like fire. Someday you will swing high, so high, higher than you ever dared to swing. Someday you will hear something so sad that you will fold up with sorrow. Someday you will call a song to the wind, and the wind will carry your song away. Someday I will stand on this porch and watch your arms waving to me until I no longer see you. Someday you will look at this house and wonder how something that feels so big can look so small. Someday you will feel a small weight against your strong back. Someday I will watch you brushing your child's hair. Someday, a long time from now, your own hair will glow silver in the sun. And when that day comes, love, you will remember me." Okay, thank you, you guys. Now, at this time, as part of this story time, I thought maybe I would invite Hoxie and Cordy to share with me a little bit from their church camp experience. Amelia, did you want to go back and play? I think Hoxie and Cordy might have a song that they'd be willing to share. Okay, I'll come here. So you'll notice that they're wearing their Camp Kasota East shirts. Did anyone, can I see a hand, if anyone in this church has ever attended or sent a child to Kasota Camp? Oh, look. Lots of people here know what Kasota is. All right, so we're going to sing a song. Do we want to sing? All right, we're going to sing I Wanna Linger. If you know the song, please join us.
I wanna linger a little longer, a little longer here with you, my friend. And that's such a perfect night. It doesn't seem quite right that this should be my last with you, my friend. And in September, I will remember my happy camping days with you, my friend. And as the years go by, I'll think of you and sigh. This is good night, but not goodbye.
Raise your hand if you remember a church camp song. Would you please join me in a prayer for illumination? It's printed in your bulletin on the second page. I'll read the first part and then you can join me in the end. O Lord, your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Give us grace to receive your truth in faith and love, and the strength to follow on the path you set before us through Jesus Christ. Amen. May I ask Joy to come and share our scripture reading?
Good morning. Carrie mentioned sweating. Try walking through the door and having being asked to read the scripture this morning. Bear with me. Our scripture is from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 to 8. And I am not sure what translation we're using here, the New Revised Standard Version. It is titled, Everything Has Its Time. For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born, and a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to pluck up that which is planted. A time to kill, and a time to heal. To utter a word before God. Is that making sense? Chapter 4. Sorry. Turn two pages. A time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to seek and a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. a time for war, and a time for peace.
I didn't do the good news.
Yes. Oh, yes.
This is what happens when you're not ready. Herein is good news. Thanks be to God.
Good job, Joy.
Thank you, Joy. I have such a frantic energy. I just knew we needed somebody really grounded and calm to sort of start us out. I love hearing Joy's voice. I feel like Joy must have had a career in the radio in one life because I just love that silky smooth voice, Miss Joy. So yes, as I said, I had a very quiet house this week. Eric and I sort of looked at each other and we thought, what do we do now? Our children were gone. And they were having a great time. They went to Kasota East Camp. There are actually two Camp Kasotas. There's an East and a West. And as I understand it, the West side, they're on the same property. You turn right into East and you turn left into West. But as I understand it, years and years ago, when they were granted the land from the province, the western side of the campgrounds was meant for the Calgary Presbytery, and the east side of the campgrounds was for the Red Deer Presbytery. Now, since then, we've sort of lost that tradition, and you can just pick and choose whichever one you want to go to. So I looked at these camps, and I looked at several camp websites, and I talked through it with the girls. Last year, they went to the same camp, and as we were looking through those websites last year and seeing all of the fun that was going to be had, there were all sorts of things that you can imagine yourself in a day in the life of a camper at Kasota East Camp. There was Gaga Ball and kitchen raids and cabin clans and pranks on other cabins and fun in the lake. And of course they were really excited about it. They had never gone to a sleepaway camp before, but as we looked at the schedule, I said, "Oh, girls, there are some options. There are some camp units where you can just go for 3 nights. And then there are other camp options that you can go for 5 nights." And they said, "Oh, no, no. We need to go to the 5-night camp, Mom. There is too much fun to have. There is crafting and tie-dye and archery. We need to go to the 5-night. This was last year. And I thought, I don't know. I really do not want to drive to Sylvan Lake in the middle of night number 4 when you decide that you miss home. So last year, I forced them to go to the 3-night camp, and they had a great time. So this year, when it came time to sign up again, we decided they were going to go to the 5-night camp. It was 6 days away from home and away from me. Hoxie, in particular, was really worried. She said, "Oh, that's a long time. I'm going to miss you, and I'm going to miss home. I'm going to miss my bed and my animals." And she was really, really nervous. But I told her, "Hoxie, it's only 5 nights. You're not moving. You're not starting a new life. You can already start to think about what we're going to do after you get home from camp. Just get through these 5 nights and try to have some fun while you're here. You're going to make so many memories. You're not going to worry about what's at home because you're going to be having too much fun and meeting too many people. But I know it's hard to be away from home sometimes. I know that firsthand. I live 3,000 kilometers away from my home and my family. I have to admit that I myself used to get really homesick." And I told Hoxie that, but I don't think she believed me. "I used to go to church camp, and I would cry every night. I was a big-time puker. I puked a lot. I would get really high-strung, and I would cry, and I would miss home. And they would always have to stick the most experienced counselor with me and take me out of the dorm or take me out of the cabin and help talk me through it. I did survive every time. But it even lasted longer than that. Even up through junior high, my mom would ship me off to music camps at universities. And I should have had a great time, but for some reason I would get really in my head and I would get really worried and I'd get really homesick. There's a family joke about how at that time, we didn't have cell phones. And so every time my mom would send me off to one of these camps, she would give me a calling card. And I'd stand in the lobby of the dormitory, or the residence hall, at whatever university my mom had sent me to a music camp. And I would stand there at the payphone and dial in like 72 numbers from the back of this calling card. And I would call home, and I'd call home every chance I got. And my poor mom Like, she'd have to sit and talk to the on the phone, like sit, because it was attached to the wall. Like, she'd have to sit there and talk to me just to say, I miss you. And there's a family joke about how one time they weren't home when I called. There was a man there laying new carpet in the family room, so I talked to him. It's true. But I would get really homesick. It was different smells and different sounds and different people, different foods that I wasn't used to, a different bed. I was very uncomfortable with the unfamiliar. Now that did change as I got older. In fact, it was almost an instant change. When I got into high school and I would go to high school camps and high school events, I really felt differently. I think I was old enough to sort of feel a little bit of sense of autonomy. I was old enough to identify with some of the other campers or the other students that were at the programs where I was. I was able to develop those connections. And it helped me feel like I belonged. I think that was it. I don't think I felt like I belonged when I was a younger camper. I think by the time I got into high school, I could look around at the other kids and especially the older kids, because I've always been a very old soul. And I think I was able to connect. A lot of times I would connect with the counselors more than I would connect with some of the other campers. But by the time I got into high school, I was feeling a lot better. I knew that I had to kind of stake my claim. I had to feel like I was on my own turf. I had to feel like I was connected with the other people there, make memories, make connections with those people. And I learned that lesson all the way through adulthood. After I graduated from high school, I moved away to Columbus, Ohio, which was a big city. And I went to school at Ohio State University. And then after that, when I graduated from college, I moved to Lincoln, Nebraska, where I had my first job. And I was there for 3 years. And then by then I had married Eric, and we moved to Ames, Iowa, where he went to veterinary school. We were there for 4 years. And then we moved all the way to Alberta. And that was a whole nother country. And every step along the way, I learned the importance of making connections, of tying myself in so that I felt like I was home, or I felt like I was on turf where I belonged. And one of the biggest ways that I learned to do that was by finding a church family. Everywhere I lived in my adult life, I have worked to find a church family. And that's not always easy. There's that uncomfortable period when you move to a new place and you do a little bit of church shopping. You have to kind of go a few times to see if you feel like you gel with these people and what they're saying and how they live and what they're doing. And sometimes it's also about the style of worship. Like, we attended church where there were really fun things happening and really families that we felt like we could get along with, but I didn't really feel comfortable in whatever style of worship it was. I grew up in a very old-fashioned church with old hymns and Beulah, who played the piano. I think she had been a saloon girl at one time because she could play a good old piano hymn. And then we would go to churches, and especially when I was in university, I would go to church services with other roommates, and it was a lot of production value, like a praise band and a lot of lights and excitement. And although that was really cool, it didn't feel like home to me, right? You have to find a family. If you don't have family with you, you have to find a family. You have to make a family. And I look around at the faces here, and this is my family. You have become our family. And as I get older, I look back at all the places that I've lived and all the jobs that I've had, and I can clearly see the seasons of my life, the excitement of graduating from high school and going off to college and being independent and in charge of myself for the first time and realizing that I didn't know how to balance a checkbook, and going off into my first job and having to sort of be responsible and have performance reports and have like a real life and pretend that I was an adult. I still find myself pretending to be an adult. I live in constant fear that someone's going to find me out because I'm still not grown up. I am 42, and I know that I've already lived many seasons of my life, but I also look forward to seasons yet to come. I am looking forward to things like retirement and grandchildren, and I also look forward to the seasons that my children are going to be experiencing. They have so much fun ahead of them, so much adventure. They're both in French immersion school, and we've already told them that when Hoxie graduates from high school, we're going to have a family trip to Quebec. And when Cordy graduates from high school, we're going to have a family trip to France, and they're going to be our interpreters. What a fun season that will be when we'll be able to travel and maneuver in the world and let our kids help guide the way. I'm looking forward to visiting them wherever they end up planting their seed and growing. Although, at this point, they're going into grades 5 and grades 4. At this point, they still like us pretty well. The latest determination has been that Hoxie's going to build a house across the drive from our house, and Cordy's going to build a house across the road from our house. And we'll all be in one kind of compound together. I don't know how long we can plan on them liking us that much, but I'm going to ride that wave until it's done. But I'm looking forward to whatever happens for them. These seasons, they come, they go, these experiences, these adventures, it's really fun to think about. I know I just had a really fun experience. My mom and my niece visited us. And so she's having the seasons of being able to come visit me where I live and bring her granddaughter to come visit us. We experience seasons in the church too. I mean, there's the obvious options: Advent, Christmas, Epiphany, Lent, Easter, Pentecost. Those are things that we celebrate every year as a church. But on a broader scale, we, the people of the church, can celebrate the seasons and mark the seasons of our lives in the church too. Baptisms, communion. My Catholic friends would celebrate First Communion. That was always a big deal, a big marker of time. Confirmation. I remember going through confirmation class. Hoxie was really excited this summer to get her Bible. Weddings, of course, would be a season of life that gets marked in the church. And yes, even funerals. I have attended many funerals as a piano player in a church, and I am always honored. I have to say, I have never found a good way to verbalize it. So I just have to say, I really enjoy going to a funeral. That's not the right way to say it, but it's an experience that really means a lot to me. I am honored to be asked by a family to share in that time in their lives. And it's a time when we gather together, we celebrate someone who has passed, we share all the good memories, we show the photos in the slideshow, we sing the meaningful songs. It's a beautiful moment for a family and for the friends of a departed person. And I'm so honored to be part of that. And I know that a lot of times we think of a funeral as like a sad occasion. It's a sorrowful moment. But I know that all of you realize that it's only sorrowful for the people here, right? The people that are left behind are the only people who are sad. I know this is a temporary time that we share when we are here on earth. This time, this season that we are in, is the 5 nights at camp that you just have to get through and try to have a few good times. The fun is yet to come. Make no mistake about that. We know in the end, just like when Hoxie went to camp, we know in the end we will be going home. Home is where we're working toward. Many of the old hymns that we sang today and that I grew up singing in my home church in Ohio have framed my thinking about this. Death is often thought of with sadness, with sorrow, maybe even fear. There is a fear of unknown, right? There's a fear of uncomfort, discomfort. But many of the leaders in the early modern church, the ones who wrote those hymns, make it seem like a total celebration. How many of the old hymns that you grew up singing talk about finally crossing over Jordan, like it's a goal we've been working toward? Think about those old hymns. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that shall be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Or one of my favorites, and I know we sing it in this church, "How Great Thou Art," when Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? We mark each of these seasons in our lives with varying degrees of joy and sorrow. There are ebbs and flow to our life. We see that as the years go by. And there is always uncertainty with any change. But the best change is yet to come. I love that. I love that. The best season is when we all get together, when we all get back home. My oldest niece just experienced a big change. I know a lot of you might remember, and I remember it very well. She just graduated from high school. I myself was very excited to graduate from high school. I was excited to go off to university, but I was also apprehensive. If you can imagine, I was a very high-strung teenager. And I felt a lot of pressure to make decisions that felt like they were going to last my lifetime. How on earth can we expect an 18-year-old idiot to know what she's supposed to be doing with the rest of her life? How I was worried about what I should be majoring in. I had a very strong allegiance to my background in agriculture. I also loved music. My mother would have loved me to pursue music. I knew that I loved the church and I loved being active, and maybe there was something for me to pursue there. I didn't know where I should be going, what I should be doing, what should my major be, how should I be conducting my life. I felt like God had given me some tools. How can I be using those? What's meant for me? And everything, this idea of meant for. Like, that's a heavy concept for an 18-year-old, right? For a flibbity-gibbet like me. It makes it seem like there's one thing. I've now come to realize that there are a lot of things. There may not be a meant for. There are a lot of things that you can do as you go through the seasons of your life to live your life to its fullest, to take advantage of the gifts God has given you, to help people, to provide positivity to the world. I know that when I felt that pressure as a child, or as an 18-year-old, 17-year-old graduating from high school, I was wound tighter than a top. I was really nervous. And I was kind of finishing out my days at home. The summer after I graduated from high school, I was working on a farm, on a hog farm. It was actually my high school agriculture teacher, her husband and his brother had a large-scale hog operation. And so I was artificially inseminating sows. I was weaning piglets, castrating piglets, feeding. It was a very glamorous job for a 17-year-old girl. I loved it. It was really good. But I knew that that summer was going to come to an end, and I was going to have to buckle down and figure out where I was going, what career path I wanted to pursue, what major I needed to claim. And I was just really at odds with myself and really kind of upended. And one of the last Sundays that I was able to worship at home in my little bitty Methodist church in Webster, Ohio, unknown, I mean, this couldn't have been planned other than it could have been planned. The choir... And they strictly say they're a no talent outfit, all right? They are just singing whatever song they feel to sing, and they just kind of do it from the heart. Our choir sang an anthem, and I was in tears. It really spoke to me about remembering that no matter what season you're in, what direction you're going, God is there with you. It shouldn't be a worry. It shouldn't be on you to feel that stress. They say, let go, let God, right? Or what would Jesus do? There are all sorts of little punchlines that we can remember that remind us that no matter what season we're in, to every season, to everything there is a season. There is time for everything in our lives. And we can know and we can measure that God is with us as we go through all those seasons. So if you'll humor me, I would love to share with you the anthem that our choir sang that last Sunday. It would have been approximately August of 1999 in Webster, Ohio. I'm going to try and sing it. Please listen to the words and know that God is with you as you're in your seasons of your life. Perfect. Are you standing at a crossroad? take, and you're dreading the decision and a possible mistake. But the will of God won't lead you where the grace of God can't keep you, and you will never be out of His care. Remember that the Lord's already there. Wherever you are, wherever you're going, God is right there beside you, seeing and knowing. Wherever you go, He already knows what lies ahead and what's behind. You'll always find He's never too far from wherever you are. You are waiting to hear thunder and see lightning in the sky. Oh, but God can work His wonders through a still small voice inside. So keep listening and learning and continue on the journey, just following the One who is the way. Yes, He's the only road you'll need to take. Wherever you are, wherever you're going, God is right there beside you, seeing and knowing. Wherever you go, He already knows what lies ahead and what's behind. You'll always find He's never too far from wherever you are. Wherever you go, He already knows what lies ahead and what's behind. You'll always find He's never too far from wherever you are. So Hoxie, next year when you're nervous about going away to camp, you can know that God will always be there with you, wherever you are. Can I get an amen, please? Amen. All right. Now, oh good, we get to sing one of my favorites. This is a hymn that I did not know prior to moving to Canada. I don't know if it wasn't in our hymnal or if I just had never experienced it in our church, but would you please stand and join me? We're going to sing Voices United number 703. This is "In the Bulb There Is a Flower." Voices United 703, "In the Bulb There Is a Flower." Would you please stand?
In the bulb there is a flower, in the seed an apple tree, in cocoons a hidden promise, butterflies will soon be free. In the cold and snow of winter, there's a spring that waits to be unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see. There's a song in every silence, seeking word and melody.
There's a dawn in every darkness, bringing hope to you and me. From the past will come the future, what it holds a mystery. Unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see. In our end is our beginning, in our time infinity. In our doubt there is believing, in our life eternity. In our death a resurrection, in the last a victory. Unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see.
Thank you. You may be seated. Would you please join me in an attitude of prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you for seeing us through the seasons of our lives. We thank you for making those times in our lives special, for giving us the joys of life and laughter, parenthood and friendship. And yes, God, we even thank you for the times of sorrow. We know that without sadness, we wouldn't know how wonderful joy can be. Without the lows, we wouldn't be able to appreciate the highs. We thank you for the seasons of our lives when we've felt your presence and the seasons when we felt like we were wandering. Help us wander to you. Help us find our way through those times of darkness and see the light that you offer. Help us get through the cold so we can feel the warmth. We know that we're not always perfect, that we don't always make the right decisions, and we appreciate the fact that you're okay with that. We love the family that you've given us here on earth, the friends, the people who support us, the people who challenge us, the people who teach us, the people who help us, the people who accept our help and give us a feeling of satisfaction. But we also look forward to the season that we get to be with you. We look forward to coming to you, coming home to the people who've come to you before us. We appreciate all the darkness and shadows throughout the course of our lives. We appreciate the light and warmth. We thank you for your son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for thinking of us as your children and creating us in his image. We thank you for giving him for our sake, for washing away our sins with the blood of your own precious Son. We pray today in strength that comes from feeling surrounded by people who love us. We pray today in confidence, being shored up with a family that supports us. But we pray also in vulnerability. Speak to us in the times when we don't feel like praying. Help us feel your presence. Help us hear your voice. Help us feel your guidance to follow the way of Jesus, to do his work in the world, to celebrate the seasons of life that you've created for us. We pray now in gratitude for your Son and for your love and for the Holy Spirit. We pray in the way Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. I now invite our ushers to bring forward our our tithes and offerings. As a church, we offer our talents, we offer our money, we offer our time, we offer the gifts that we've been given to do the work of God in the world. We know that we are the living body of God, and we welcome all the tithes and all the talents that we offer to the world. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the goods that you've given us. We recognize that so much of our ability to earn a living comes from you, and we use that ability to give back to you and your work in the world and to your church to do good. Amen. Would you please stand and join me in one of my favorite hymns, every single one of these, my favorite hymn. This is number 352 in Voices United, I Danced in the Morning. I danced in the morning when the world was begun, and I danced in the moon and the stars and the sun, and I came down from heaven and I danced on the earth. At Bethlehem I had my birth. Dance then wherever you may be, I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I'll lead you all wherever you may be, and I'll lead you all in the dance, said he. I danced for the scribe and the Pharisees, but they would not dance and they would not follow me. I danced for the fishermen, for James and John, they came with me and the dance went on. Dance, dance, wherever you may be, I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I'll lead you all wherever you may be, and I'll lead you all in the dance, said he. I danced on the Sabbath and I cured the lame. The holy people said it was a shame. They whipped and they stripped and they hung me high and left me there on the cross to die. Dance, dance, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I'll lead you all wherever you may be, and I'll lead you all in the dance, said he. I danced on the Friday when the sky turned black. It's hard to dance with the devil on your back. They buried my body and they thought I'd gone, but I am the dance and I still go on. Dance then wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he, and I'll lead you all wherever you may be, and I'll lead you all in the dance, said he. They cut me down and I leapt up high. I am the life that will never, never die. I'll live in you if you'll live in me. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. Dance, dance, wherever you may be. I am the Lord of the dance, said he. Thank you for worshiping with me today. Thank you for walking this little path with me for the last hour. Oh no, My Methodist family would be scandalized. It's 1 minute after 11. Dang. Promptly 1 hour. That's the limit. Promptly at 1 hour. Thank you so much for humoring me and helping me celebrate my nostalgia and my melancholy this week. I love the season that I'm in. I'm looking forward to the seasons that are coming. I hope all of you are too. May you go forth knowing that God journeys with you in each of the seasons of your life. Go forth feeling his presence as you conduct your day, your year, your life. In the name of God, amen.